this new chapter, let us now try to understand what happens if the charge starts to move. So in the previous chapters we discuss about charge at rest. So when the charge starts to move, there are two things. First, electric field is generated, and secondly, magnetic field is also generated. So we will discuss about the magnetic field in the next chapters, but for now we will focus on the charge when it moves and it produces electric field. So that electricity is called current electricity. When charge moves and it generates electric field electricity, then we say that it is current electricity. When charge was at rest, it was static electricity. So let's first try to understand the different charge carriers in different materials or different current carriers. So in solids, there are three types of materials: conductors, insulators, and semiconductors. And also there is superconductor also, but superconductor are special types of conductors only. Then in liquids we have ions, and in gas also we have ions. So what happens is that in solids, when we have conductors are the materials having free electrons. Insulators are the conductors which have bound electrons, that is electrons which are bounded to their atoms. And in semiconductors, we have two types of particles. One is electron and one is the holes, which are considered to be positive particles. So when we will discuss about semiconductors, you will understand more about electrons and holes. So in solids, the charge carriers are usually electrons and sometimes a few holes. But in liquids and in gases, positive and negative ions are the reason behind the current. For example, if we have NaCl solution, NaCl that is salt solution, then in NaCl solution, current is carried by the Na positive and Cl negative ions. So these ions carry the charge, or these ions carry the current. And similarly in the gases also, ionization takes place, and because of that, positive and negative ions carry the current. Now let's try to understand, in this chapter we will mainly focus about the conductors. So let's try to understand first the meaning of current. So current is quite simple to understand. It is a rate of flow of charges through a cross section in a particular direction. That is, let's suppose we have this wire. Now let's consider this region. So what is current? So the rate of flow of electrons through this region per second is called current. More the electrons flowing per second through this region, more will be the current. So current is rate of flow of charge in a particular direction. Current is a scalar quantity, and its unit is ampere. Coulomb per second is also called ampere. So current is measured in amperes. Also, you can replace this Q by Ne, so we can also write current as Ne by T. The CGS unit of current is state ampere. The CGS unit is state ampere. So 1 ampere is equal to 3 into 10 to the power 9 state amperes. Now there are two types of currents. One is a direct current and one is the alternating current. So the major difference between direct and alternating current is that in direct current the direction does not change, and in alternating current the direction of the current changes. But let's try to go further. Direct current can be classified as non-pulsating or pulsating, or you can also say time invariant and time varying. That is something which is changing with time or not. So when the direct current is non-pulsating, that is there is no pulse, it is time invariant, that is it is constant with time, its magnitude does not change with time. So in direct current which is non-pulsating, the direction and magnitude both remain same. But in pulsating DC, the direction does not change, okay, it is in the positive direction only. But the magnitude is changing, it is changing. So in pulsating DC, the magnitude change, but the direction remains same. So this is direct current. Now in alternating current, the magnitude is changing as well as the direction is changing. First it was positive direction, then negative direction, and so on. So in alternating current, magnitude and direction both change. So there are two types of currents, direct current and alternating current. Now after current, let's try to understand current density. So just like charge and charge density, mass and mass density, we have current and current density. So in current density, we usually discuss about the area. So current per unit area is called the current density. The unit is ampere upon meter square, which is quite simple to understand. So current density is a vector quantity and its direction is perpendicular to the surface. This is normal, so it is perpendicular to the surface. So current density is the rate of flow of change in current with respect to area. Current density is the change in current with respect to area, or in simple terms, current upon area. So more the current in a particular area, more will be the current density. Now there are two types of velocities for charged particles. Remember, in conductors only electrons are moving. Remember this, and we are only discussing about conductors. So first is the thermal velocity and second is the drift velocity. So thermal velocity is the velocity of the charged particles because of the random motion due to internal energy or the temperature. So we know that all the materials have particles in them, all the solids have particles in them, and those particles are vibrating or moving in the solid. So that random motion generates the temperature or internal energy. So more the internal energy, more the temperature, more will be the thermal velocity. So let's say if one conductor is at 10 degrees Celsius, its thermal velocity will be less as compared to the conductor at 100 degrees Celsius. So thermal velocity is the random motion of electrons due to temperature. And drift velocity, it is the, let's say we are applying some electric field or potential difference or voltage to the wire. So then what will happen? Let's say this is the positive terminal of battery, this is the negative terminal of battery. So what will happen? Negative electrons will try to get attracted towards the positive terminal. So all the particles will try to move in a particular direction. So motion in a particular direction due to external electric field or potential is called drift velocity. They are drifting in a particular direction. So thermal velocity and drift velocity. So these are few important relations here. First of all, Vd is the drift velocity here. Let me write it. This is the drift velocity. Drift velocity. Then E is the charge of electron. Capital E is the electric field. Tau is the relaxation time. Mass of electron. Me is the mass of electron. Now what is relaxation time? So when the charged particles move in the wire, what happens is that they collide with other particles. So the time between two collisions is called the relaxation time. Time between two successive collisions is called relaxation time. And there is also one term called free path. This is a time, this is a path between two successive collisions. So when the electrons are moving in the wire, they collide with other electrons and other atoms. So the time period between successive collision is relaxation time. And path between successive collision is free path. So this is the relation between drift velocity and the relaxation time. Now let's try to write the relation between the current density and drift velocity and current and drift velocity. So this is the relation. Current is equal to Ne AVD, where N is the number of electrons, E is the charge of electron, A is the area of the cross section area of the wire, Vd is the drift velocity. Now we know that current upon area is current density. So just put A here. So current upon area will be equal to J. So it will be equal to Ne Vd. So current density is Ne Vd. So current is directly proportional to Vd and current density is directly proportional to Vd. So this means that more the drift velocity, more is the current, and it is quite understandable because what is current? Current is the flow of electrons in a particular direction. So if we have more electrons in a particular direction, that is, if we have more drift velocity of electrons, then we will have more current. Current and current density, let's try to understand voltage. So voltage is also known as potential difference. Potential difference is the difference of potentials between two points. Now let's try to we understood the meaning of potential. Potential was the amount of work done per unit charge in bringing a charge from infinity to a point A in the electric field. So potential difference was also understood that it is the difference of potential between two points. So potential difference or voltage. So what is the importance of voltage here? So it can be understood that if there is a potential difference, or let's say if there is height difference between two water bodies, let's say one is this and one is this, let's say water is up to here, water is up to here. So what will happen? There will be net flow of water from this jar to this jar, and the net flow of water will be till when the level of water becomes equal in both the jars. So there is a potential difference, and because of that height difference, the water flow in one direction. Similarly, when we have charges, electric charges, then if there is potential difference, if there is voltage, then the charges can flow in the particular direction. So let's say if we have this terminal which is more positive and this terminal is very negative. So what will happen is that if we connect the circuit, then the electrons will try to move towards the positive terminal, and they will get repelled from the negative terminal. So the flow of electrons in this particular direction is made possible because of the difference of potentials. One potential was positive and one potential was negative. So current only flow when there is potential difference between the concerned points. So for example, if we have same potentials, then no current will be there, and if we have different potentials, then there will be a current in the circuit. Now one important thing to note, let's say this is our circuit. Now remember, this is positive and negative terminal. So what happens is that the electrons move towards the positive terminal, okay, like this. So the flow of electron is like this, but the direction of current is considered to be from positive terminal to the negative terminal. The direction of current is considered to be like this, from positive terminal to negative terminal. So in this case, the current will be in this direction. So the direction of current and the direction of flow of electrons is opposite to each other. Remember this, keep it in mind. Now let's move on to the third important thing in this chapter. First was current, second was voltage, and now resistance. So resistance is the property which opposes the flow of charge. So we will understand more about resistance in a while, but for now just remember that resistance opposes the flow of charge, and resistor is a device which provides the resistance. So before understanding more about resistance, let's try to understand Ohm's law. So there was this scientist called George Ohm. He observed that voltage in conductor, voltage is directly proportional to the current. That is, if we increase the voltage, current increase. If we decrease the voltage, current decrease, and by the same amount. Okay, so voltage and current are linearly related. So when he removed the proportionality and introduced the equal to sign, then a new term was introduced, R, which is called the resistance. So R is V by I. So what is R? R is the resistance. We will again come to the meaning of resistance after the Ohm's law. So let's focus on this graph. So how can you find resistance from this graph? So resistance is V by I. So we know that the slope of this graph, we know that it is y2 minus y1 upon x2 minus x1. So here y is I and x is v. So slope is I by v. So in this graph, the slope is 1 by r. So if you need to find the resistance from this graph, then find the inverse of the slope, that is 1 by m. Now there is this formula of resistance. We will understand this formula better in a moment. So in this formula, m is the mass of electron, n is the number of electrons, e is the charge of electron, tau is the relaxation time, l is the length of the wire, a is the area of the cross section of the wire. So this is the formula for resistance. And there is this another term called resistivity. Resistivity is this initial term, m upon ne square tau. This is resistivity. Now I will tell you everything about resistance and resistivity, their physical significance, etc. So just wait for it. So resistance has the unit called ohm. The unit of resistance is ohm, and the unit of resistivity is ohm into meter, ohm meter. So now let's try to understand the meaning of resistance. So what is resistance? So we know that when we have charged particles moving in the wire, they collide with each other. Now because of the collision, there is this hindrance to the flow of particles. Obviously, if you collide with other particles, your motion will be hindered. So more the collision, more will be the hindrance, and that hindrance to the motion or flow of charge is called resistance. So more collision, more resistance, and whenever particles collide, whenever there is resistance, then heat is generated. Heat is generated, energy is lost in the form of heat. So more collision, more resistance, more heat. Less collision, less resistance, less heat. So what is the physical significance? Resistance is produced due to the collision of electrons or the charged particles with other electrons or other atoms, and it generates heat, which is the which makes resistance very useful sometimes and also very harmful sometimes. We will come to that after discussing resistivity. So now what is resistivity? So resistivity is the resistance of a conductor for a unit area and unit length. When we talk about the resistance of a unit area or unit length of any wire, then it is called resistivity. For example, if you have 10 meter long wire, then the opposition in the complete wire is called the resistance. But if you want to find the opposition in the unit area unit length wire, that is 1 meter long wire and 1 meter square area wire, then its opposition will be called the resistivity. So resistance of a unit area and unit length is called resistivity. It is represented by rho, and it is also called specific resistance. So now let's try to understand the factors on which resistance depends. So resistance depends, as discussed, this is the formula for resistance. So if look closely on this formula. So resistance depends on the length of the wire. More the length of the wire, more will be the resistance. It can be understood by analogy of the traffic. If you travel for more, chance of collision or accident will be more. So similarly, more length, more collision, more resistance. Cross-sectional area. If cross-sectional area is more, resistance is less. Resistance is inversely proportional to cross-sectional area. Then material of conductor. So resistance depend on the number of free electrons present in the conductor. So if free electrons are more, resistance is less. If free electrons are less, then the resistance is more. So every material has different number of free electrons, therefore their resistance is different. Now the resistance also depends on the temperature. So we know that temperature means increase in the kinetic energy of the particles. So if the temperature increase, then the collision becomes very quick. Relaxation time decrease, temperature increase, relaxation time decrease, and resistance becomes more because there are more collisions. Quite simple. If you travel for a very if you go very fast, then the chance of accident will be more. Similarly, if temperature increase, particles go fast and their collision increase. So resistance depends on four factors. Similarly, resistivity also depends on few factors. Most importantly, resistivity does not depend on the length and area, because in resistivity we are defining the length to be 1 meter and cross-sectional area to be 1 meter square. So it only depends on temperature and nature of conductor, just like resistance. Okay, just like resistance, if temperature increase, resistivity increase, and if the number of free electrons are more, then the resistivity is less, and vice versa. Now this formula is very helpful. If you need to find the temperature dependence of resistance or resistivity, you can use this formula. The main formula is this one. So here this RT is the resistance at temperature T, R0 is the resistance at temperature 0 degree Celsius, then alpha is the temperature coefficient, and T is the temperature at which we want to find the resistance. So So from here alpha becomes RT minus R0 upon R0T. And similar formula is for resistivity. So what is alpha? Alpha, temperature coefficient. So for conductors, the temperature coefficient alpha is positive. What does it mean? It means that if we increase the temperature, then the resistance of the conductors increase. But in semiconductors, it is reverse. In semiconductors, if the temperature is increased, then the resistance decreases. So alpha of semiconductors is negative. And if we have some alloys, alloys are the mixture of different metals and non-metals. So there are alloys which are of high resistivity. So in them, the resistivity does not change much with the temperature. So alpha is zero for the high resistivity alloys. So alpha depends on the material. Conductor, it is positive. Semiconductor, it is negative. High resistive elements, it is zero. Now there is this term called conductance. So the inverse of resistance is conductance, and the inverse of resistivity is called the conductivity. Also specific resistance is resistivity is also called specific resistance, and conductivity is also called specific conductance. Now the unit of conductance is Siemens, and unit of conductivity is Siemens per meter. So ultimately what we have, Ohm's law, V equal to IR. Now there is this another form of Ohm's law. These two forms are also there. Now this is quite simple. At the place of potential we have electric field. At the place of current we have current density. And at the place of resistance we have resistivity. And similarly, this can also be written like this. This is the modified version. What we have done is E upon rho is equal to J. So we know that 1 by rho is conductivity. So E sigma into J. So this is how we get this formula. So this is the Ohm's law in other forms, in the form of electric field and current density.